Ustekinumab has been tested in two patient populations, those who have been primarily naive to prior biologics, again, that's primarily TNF inhibitors, and also in biologic naive patients. As we've seen with all therapies, in the earlier patients, the less refractory patients, the bio-naive patients, we actually get better outcomes than we get in patients who are more refractory and experienced with biologics. But nevertheless, the outcomes are significantly superior to placebo in both groups of patients. We also have a long safety experience with ustekinumab. It has been on the market for psoriasis for over 8 years, so we have many thousands of patient years experience. There is a small risk of infection, but that really hasn't been identified in the Crohn's populations. In these individuals with Crohn's disease, they're not just treated with ustekinumab. Many have been on corticosteroids or immunosuppressives as well. So any of the side effects need to be discriminated from ustekinumab versus the other concomitant agents. But overall, ustekinumab has been very safe. In the psoriatic population that has been exposed to ultraviolet light, there has been an increased risk of non-melanotic skin cancers, but we have yet to see that in the Crohn's population. The induction dose of ustekinumab is 6 mg/kg administered intravenously. Then maintenance is with 90 milligrams subcutaneous every 8 weeks.
The biologic rationale for blocking interleukin-12 and interleukin-23 in Crohn's disease harkens back to the genetics of these diseases. Actually, if you look at genetic risk factors for both Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis, you find many loci that involve the IL-12 and IL-23 pathway, and that includes the IL-23 receptor gene. And quite interestingly, there's one polymorphism that actually is protective for the development of Crohn's disease, which suggests that if you block IL-23, that may be beneficial. Aside from that, we've learned from many animal models of inflammatory bowel disease that IL-12 and IL-23 are elevated, and that if you block those cytokines, that actually the inflammation in those models goes away. And finally, in human tissues, if you measure interleukin-12 and interleukin-23, you'll find that those cytokines are elevated. So altogether, this provides very strong rationale for wanting to block these very important cytokines, which are involved in adaptive immune responses in IBD. The last thing to say is that these cytokines have a lot in common. They're both heterodimer molecules. They share one component, which is the P40 component. So when you have an antibody, such as ustekinumab, that blocks P40, you're actually blocking both IL-12 and IL-23.
So one question that comes up is how long you can continue ustekinumab therapy and how long the remission might last. It's really quite a highly durable drug. It's interesting, it has a half-life of about 25 days, so it's the doses are long-lasting. You can dose the patients every 8 weeks during the maintenance phase with subcutaneous dosing, and what we see is that the maintenance effect in the clinical trials was really solid over time. You didn't see a lot of loss, so I've found this in the clinical trials and in practice to be a very useful maintenance agent.